Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Germantown, a military history of the Battle for Philadelphia, October 4, 1777, by Michael Harris, narrated by Tom Perkins. Preface. My first book, Brandywine, a military history of the battle that lost Philadelphia but saved America, September 11, 1777, appeared 6 years ago. Once it was finished, I was certain I would not embark on the adventure of writing another. I was deeply invested in the Brandywine story and believed it was my mission to dispel the many myths surrounding the battle. Speaking with people at events and book signings confirmed that there was a deep desire for well-documented military studies on American Revolution topics. Many gracious enough to come and hear a presentation, get a book signed, or join me on a battlefield tour expressed a desire for a follow-up work. I politely declined. When the urge hit, however, I would dig into my research files now and again and discover that I had collected a substantial body of research on the phase of the war that picked up where the Brandywine story ended. The months passed. I proposed the idea to my publisher, and the result is now in your hands. Germantown, a military history of the Battle for Philadelphia, October 4, 1777. Like Brandywine, there were more than enough first-hand accounts to write a solid monograph on Germantown, which erupted just 3 weeks later on October 4, 1777. Germantown was one of the war's largest battles and another in a string of American losses, but there was less written about Germantown than there had been for Brandywine. As I came to discover, this is often true for American losses, especially those fought on battlefields not under the care and protection of the National Park Service, including, but not limited to, Long Island, White Plains, Brandywine, Germantown, and Camden. Despite the defeat, the American Army remained in high spirits in the days and weeks following the battle, and many of its members believed the war was nearly won. Some referenced the hand of God in the outcome. Unfortunate as was the issue of the battle at Germantown, it manifested the unsubdued, though broken spirit of the American Army, and taught the enemy to expect renewal of combat whenever adequacy of force or fitness of opportunity should authorize repetition of battle, explained Henry Light Horse Harry Lee, one of Washington's cavalry officers. It gave, too, animation to the country at large, exciting in Congress and in the people, invigorated zeal in the great cause in which they were engaged. Major Henry Miller agreed. Our army is in higher spirits than ever, being convinced from the first officer to the soldier that our quitting the field must be ascribed to other causes than the force of the enemy, for even they acknowledged that we fled from victory. We hope to meet them soon again, Miller continued, and, with the assistance of Providence, to restore to our suffering citizens their possessions and homes. Germantown was overshadowed not only by Brandywine, but by the stunning American victory at Saratoga just days later. Most works relegate it to a few paragraphs. William Gordon's 1788 History of America's Establishment covered one of the largest attacks of the war in just 4 pages. The British officers acknowledged soon after this affair that it was the severest blow they had met with, that it was planned with judgment and executed with spirit, and that they were at a loss for its not being followed up, unless it was for want of ammunition, wrote the author. At the end of the basic battle summary, Gordon succinctly concluded, General Washington is of opinion that the Americans retreated at an instant when victory was declaring in their favor. The Royal Army was indeed completely surprised, and appearances in the beginning were evidently on the side of the former. More than 40 years would elapse before another book offered anything significant on Germantown. Most writers focused on the morning fog and the fight at Cliveden. The principal causes of the failure of this well-concerted enterprise, wrote Charles Botta in his 1845 History of the Revolution, were the extreme haziness of the weather, which was so thick that the Americans could neither discover the situation nor movements of the British army, nor yet those of their own, and finally the unexpected resistance of Musgrave, who found means in a critical moment to transform a mere house into an impregnable fortress. That same year, Jacob Neff published a history of armed forces in North America and regurgitated Botta's summary word for word. 2 years later, in 1847, George Lippard poetically described the fighting at Cliveden by assigning a part in the action to Washington himself that never occurred. "Follow me who will," he cried, and in a moment his steed of iron gray was careering over the sod, littered with ghastly corpses, while the air overhead was alive with the music of bullets and earth beneath was flung against the war steed's flanks by the cannonball. At every step a dead man with a livid face turned upward, little pools of blood crimsoning the lawn, torn fragments of attire scattered over the sod, on every side hurrying bodies of the foemen, while terrible and unremitting, the fire flashing from the windows of Chew's house flung a lurid glare over the battlefield. Washington dashed over the lawn. He approached the house, and every man of his train held his breath. Bullets were whistling over their heads, cannonballs playing round their horses' feet, yet their leader kept on his way of terror. A single glance at the house, with its volleys of flame flashing from every window, and he turned to the north to regain the American lines. But the fog and smoke gathered round him, and he found his horse entangled amid the enclosures of the cattle pen to the north of the mansion. Lippard continued his exaggerated account of Washington. "Leap your horses," cried Washington to the brave men around him. "Leap your horses and save yourselves." And in a moment, amid the mist and gloom, his officers leaped the northern enclosure of the cattle pen and rode forward to the American line, scarcely able to discover their path in the dense gloom that gathered around them. They reached the American lines and, to their horror, discovered that Washington was not among their band. He had not leaped the fence of the cattle pen. With the feeling of a true warrior, he was afraid of injuring his gallant steed by this leap in the dark. He rose proudly in the stirrups. He placed his hand gently on the neck of his steed. He glanced proudly round him, and then the noble horse sprang forward with a sudden leap, and the mist rising for a moment disclosed the form of Washington to the vision of the opposing armies. In the 1850s, as the country tore itself apart over the issue of slavery, Republicans and Democrats conjured up revolutionary heroes to support their cause. In October 1856, members of the recently formed Republican Party held a grand gathering on the ground where the Revolutionary Battle of Germantown was fought, and invoked a time hallowed in our country's history when patriots poured out their blood in a struggle for freedom. As these Republicans urged their followers to fight for freedom again, they hoped the grounds of Germantown will ring with the cries of freedom for bleeding Kansas. In 1858, Lord Mahon praised the effort of the Continentals in his History of England. "Yet, defeat though it was, this battle brought no discredit, but the contrary to the American troops and the American commander. It showed that neither their spirit nor their strength had been broken by the reverses they had sustained. It proved them to want only that discipline and self-confidence which longer warfare was certain to produce." During the Civil War, the country looked toward revolutionary heroes as a source of patriotism. Very few veterans of the Revolution were still alive, and Reverend Elias Hillard set out to interview those he could find before they died. Hillard, wrote one modern historian, was from a school of thought that strove not to chronicle events explicitly, but instead to personalize them and derive allegory from them. The nation, divided by civil war, needed heroes to instill a sense of unity and national pride. It also needed to stimulate the heroism that would be required to heal the still bleeding nation. Men like Washington, Jefferson, Adams, Madison, Franklin, and many other famous demigods of the nation's founding were gone, and the contemporaries of Hillard's time, including Abraham Lincoln and Ulysses S. Grant, had yet to transcend the controversies and contempt that befall living men of accomplishment. The few remaining men who had lived and fought through the Revolution were true symbols of a bygone glorious cause. No matter how modest their contributions, and no matter how divisive the actual Revolution had been, veterans of that conflict were ideal candidates to be made perfect in the eyes of a public hungry for heroes. In search of his allegory, Hillard stretched the truth when chronicling the stories of these living heroes. George Bancroft's 1866 History of the United States is one of the earliest accounts to tie the importance of Germantown to the French alliance that followed. The renewal of an attack so soon after the defeat at the Brandywine and its partial success inspirited Congress and the Army. In Europe, stressed Bancroft, it convinced the cabinet of the King of France that the independence of America was assured. By the end of the 19th century, changes affecting America influenced how the story of the Revolution was told. The transformation from a collection of rural economies into an industrialized nation after the Civil War tarnished the idealistic view many Americans had about their country. The earlier period glorified war and emphasized the greatness of heroes like Washington and Lafayette. The carnage wrought by the Civil War, however, went a long way toward eliminating that mindset. Post-war industrialization, coupled with the massive influx of European immigrants, brought class struggles to the forefront of American consciousness. The writing of history started emphasizing the role of the common man rather than heroes or the upper class. On the centennial of the battle, newspaper editor Alfred Lambden delivered an address that doubled as an early account of the battle. Lambden was one of the first to acknowledge the battle was more extensive than just the fighting that swirled around Cliveden. The Battle of Germantown was very much more than a contest with a half dozen companies for the possession of a country house, he insisted. It was a contest for the possession of a widely extended and strongly posted line between two armies, not large indeed, according to our modern ideas, but such as not often met face to face in the War for Independence. More than three decades passed before Francis Hale's The Battle of Germantown in 1908. Splendid was the material which made up the rank and file of the American army at Germantown, the flower of the young manhood of New England, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, Maryland, Virginia, and North Carolina, he penned. All honor to the brave and patriot soldiers who periled their lives at Germantown to maintain the liberties of their country. 4 years later, British statesman and author Sir George Otto Trevelyan continued the theme that Germantown had influenced the French court. That the battle had been fought unsuccessfully was of small importance when weighed against the fact that it had been fought at all, stressed Trevelyan. Eminent generals and statesmen of sagacity in every European court were profoundly impressed by learning that a new army, raised within the year, and undaunted by a series of recent disasters, had assailed a victorious enemy in his own quarters and had only been repulsed after a sharp and dubious conflict. A handbook published in 1927 for the 150th anniversary of the battle also mentioned the influence on France. The military results of the battle were a disappointment to Washington and others. Still, they did not dishearten the rank and file of the army who, in a day or two, were hoping for another brush with the enemy. The political effect was decidedly favorable to the American cause, eventually bringing France into the war as an ally of the struggling republic. Christopher Ward's outstanding The War of the Revolution, a two-volume history published in 1952, devoted 9 pages to Germantown and summarized the fighting as unquestionably a defeat for the Americans, but, as has happened more than once in warfare, that fact was of small consequence in comparison with its ulterior effects. Yet another reference to the coming French alliance. John Reed's Campaign to Valley Forge, July 1, 1777 to December 19, 1777, made its appearance in 1965. The study is now considered a classic and stands up against many later monographs. Germantown has its own 24-page chapter. While Reed gets some basic facts incorrect, his sources are mostly documented, unlike some newer works on the campaign. Like others, Reed connects Germantown to Saratoga. Most wars have a single node or turning point. The American Revolution had several. Each time the cause seemed lost, some magnificent event lifted the cause into being again. The combination of Germantown and Saratoga was one of these events. The war's bicentennial saw a resurgence in the publication of books and articles on the American Revolution. Only two dealt in any meaningful way with Germantown. John Pancake's 1777, The Year of the Hangman, covered Germantown in just 6 pages, provided few details, and offered no new conclusions. Historian John Jackson researched and wrote on the British occupation of Philadelphia and the fighting along the Delaware River, and provided a 22-page chapter on Germantown in his The British Army in Philadelphia, 1777-1778. Jackson's study covered most aspects of the battle but lacked eyewitness accounts. Much has been written about the rashness of Washington's strategy, the elaborate plan, and the impossibility of coordinating attacks by the various columns, wrote Jackson. Washington's plan undoubtedly would have taxed the abilities of the most veteran soldiers. In spite of the reverses, it did not depress the average American soldier. Despite the size and scale of the engagement, W.J. Wood's well-received and reviewed Battles of the Revolutionary War, 1775-1781, 1990, does not even mention Germantown. Wood believed Brandywine and Saratoga overshadowed it into insignificance. David Martin's 1993, The Philadelphia Campaign, June 1777 to July 1778, includes an 18-page chapter on the battle but lacks documentation and misrepresents several aspects of the contending forces. Angel in the Whirlwind, The Triumph of the American Revolution, a 1997 book by Benson Bobrick, briefly mentions Germantown, though it does connect the battle to the French alliance. In Europe, the battle was taken as proof of the Americans' ability to win the war, explained Bobrick. As a result, there began an inexorable shift in the policy and attitude of the European states. Finally, Gregory Edgar's 1998, The Philadelphia Campaign, 1777-1778, relied on undocumented block quotes of battle participants in its 15-page chapter on the engagement. None of these works did anything to further the understanding and history of the Battle of Germantown. Germantown has been the subject of just 2 previous book-length treatments. Of those, Donald Brownlow's 1955 study, A Documentary History of the Battle of Germantown, is by far the best. It is also a rare book. The only copy I have ever seen was given to me as a gift by an admirer of my Brandywine book. Brownlow's work is well-researched and even-handed for its age and provides both British and American accounts. His conclusion includes this summary: The bright stars of Trenton and Princeton were dulled by the gloomy atmosphere rendered by the succession of defeats, Brandywine, Paoli, and Germantown. However, the victory at Saratoga boosted the morale in the colonies. The only other book on the battle appeared 39 years later than Brownlow's. Thomas McGuire's 1994, The Surprise at Germantown, October 4, 1777, a short study that focuses mainly on the fighting around Cliveden to the detriment of other important aspects of the battle. McGuire improved upon his earlier work in the second installment of his 2-volume set on the Philadelphia Campaign, which appeared in 2007. In The Philadelphia Campaign, Germantown, and the Roads to Valley Forge, McGuire went a long way toward rectifying the aspects of the battle he had neglected in his first installment by devoting 82 pages to Germantown. He is an impeccable researcher, but a lack of quality maps make it more than difficult to understand the ebb and flow of his narrative and the complex action it attempts to describe. A new study. An even-handed, in-depth study of Germantown is long overdue. In addition to being one of the largest battles of the war, it is also significant because it was the first time George Washington launched an assault against the main British army in North America. But the once rolling fields over which Continental and British soldiers struggled have been mostly destroyed by urban blight. Now, engulfed by Philadelphia, Germantown is no longer the small village surrounded by fields and woodlots that it was in 1777. Researching on the ground to analyze the terrain is almost impossible, and one more reason why the battle has been mostly neglected. My hope is that this study satisfies those looking for the most recent research, coupled with good maps, insightful footnotes, and a complete order of battle. While the focus of this book is the Battle of Germantown, it is impossible to fully understand that engagement without knowing what transpired between Brandywine and Germantown. All of this is a prelude to Germantown. This period is also when Washington's men became battle-hardened troops on their way to the Army's Great Awakening at Valley Forge that winter. Without this understanding, a complete picture of what happened at Germantown and why would be impossible. Introduction. The origins of the 1777 campaign. By the spring of 1777, the American Revolution was entering its third year. Most of 1776 was one disaster after another for American hopes. The fledgling Continental Congress declared independence from Great Britain that summer, but the rest of the year witnessed the failed attempt to make Canada the 14th colony, the defeat of General George Washington's army on Long Island and loss of New York City to British occupation, and the retreat and rapid disintegration of the Continental Army across New Jersey that autumn. With Christmas approaching, General William Howe and the British Army settled snugly in winter quarters, believing that victory would arrive quickly the following spring. General Washington, the commander of the nascent American Army, had different plans. In a daring raid the day after Christmas, Washington's troops defeated the Hessian garrison at Trenton, New Jersey. A bit more than a week later, Washington stunned the British High Command a second time with a successful maneuver at Trenton, followed by a second victory at Princeton. The Patriot successes forced Howe to withdraw his scattered and now vulnerable outposts into the New York City area, leaving Washington to move the remnant of his army into the mountains around Morristown, New Jersey for the winter. While Washington began rebuilding his command, a perplexed Howe pondered his course of operations for 1777. British planning. As early as 1775, British strategy revolved around isolating New England, viewed as the core of the rebellion, from the other colonies. If the Hudson River Lake Champlain corridor was seized, the New England region would lose its physical connections to and support from the rest of the country. Seizing New York City the next year was a part of this plan. If successful, Howe could then move north along the Hudson River, join forces with a command marching south from Canada, and together strike east into Massachusetts. Lord George Germain, the Secretary of State for the American Department, was an advocate for this move, which was called the Hudson River Plan. A memorandum later found in his papers outlined this British strategy. By our having the entire command of the communication between Canada and New York, which is both convenient and easy, being almost altogether by water, the troops from both these provinces will have it in their power to act in conjunction, as occasion or necessity may require. In consequence whereof, the provinces of New England will be surrounded on all sides, whether by His Majesty's troops or navy, and liable to be attacked from every quarter, which will oblige them to divide their force for the protection of their frontier settlements, while at the same time all intercourse between them and the colonies to the southward of the Hudson's River will be entirely cut off. Following the relatively easy capture of New York City, Howe proposed moving up the Hudson, which was in line with Great Britain's original strategic thinking. Howe sent his proposal to Germain in late November 1776. He would need a 10,000-man force to penetrate Massachusetts from Rhode Island, and an additional 10,000 men to move north along the Hudson. Finally, Howe urged that 8,000 troops remain in New Jersey to block the remnant of Washington's army. Howe planned to use that smaller force to keep Washington busy while the two stronger columns implemented the New England strategy. Howe hoped his bold plan would bring an end to the war by the end of 1777. With the Americans reeling on all fronts by November 1776, Howe's plan appeared feasible. Lord Germain believed the destruction of the Continental armed forces in the field was the key to victory. Howe, on the other hand, advocated that the occupation of colonial territory was the ticket to success. The more colonial territory under British control, he argued, the more loyalists would have the opportunity to regain control of provincial affairs and restore the crown's authority. To achieve victory, Howe intended to move through the countryside with impressive strength through centers of rebellion, relying upon overawing the disaffected, animating the loyal, and demonstrating to the wavering the futility of resistance. Howe's thoughts on how to conduct the war contrasted with Washington's. The American general was more than willing to lose territory and cities if it meant preserving his fighting strength. By late December 1776, Howe's thinking changed. Washington was beaten, likely despondent, and fleeing west across New Jersey. Instead of shifting his units into the Hudson River Valley, Howe pursued the beaten Americans who, by December 20th, had crossed the Delaware River into Pennsylvania. The ease with which New Jersey was occupied convinced Howe to change this strategy. Rather than move up the Hudson, as he had earlier advocated, Howe now believed he could capture the colonial capital of Philadelphia with similar ease. Washington would be forced to defend the American capital with a beaten and demoralized army. He could be lured into battle on Howe's terms and crushed. An American defeat, followed by the occupation of the capital, would bring about ultimate victory. To capture the enemy's capital city, according to sound European strategy, was to all but win the war. Throughout the Revolution, British leadership remained convinced that the loyalists of North America would rise and support the British government if given the opportunity to do so. Philadelphia was believed to be a hotbed of loyalism. Joseph Galloway, former Speaker of the Pennsylvania Assembly, convinced Howe the loyalists there would rush to his support. In what would prove a gross exaggeration, Galloway told Howe that as much as 90% of Pennsylvanians were loyal to the crown, and they would openly support Great Britain if given the chance. Howe, in turn, wrote that the citizens of the middle colonies were disposed to peace, in which sentiment they would be confirmed by our getting possession of Philadelphia. I am, from this consideration, fully persuaded. The principal army should act offensively on that side, where the enemy's chief strength will certainly be collected. William Howe was abandoning the Hudson River plan, at least in part, before it had even begun. The Northern Army under General Guy Carleton would continue moving south out of Canada as planned, but Howe had his eyes firmly set on taking Philadelphia. To his way of thinking, Carleton's army could not reach Albany, New York before September, which left Howe plenty of time to march toward Philadelphia, achieve a victory over Washington, capture the city, and transfer to the Hudson River to join forces with Carleton before fall. In Howe's mind, the capture of Philadelphia trumped all else. This strategy, observed historian Richard Ketchum, demonstrated an unwillingness to recognize that the capture of Philadelphia, beyond its potential psychological impact on rebels and loyalists, could not in itself determine the outcome of the war. Such a capture, Ketchum continued, in strategic as well as geographic terms, led nowhere. For Howe to win in 1777, he must destroy Washington's army, and seizing a piece of real estate, no matter how valuable, was no way to achieve that. Howe had barely adjusted his strategic thinking when the double defeats at Trenton and Princeton rocked him. Those setbacks notwithstanding, Howe remained convinced that moving on Philadelphia was still the right plan and the key to the final campaign and ultimate victory. The suggestion is that I ought to have gone up Hudson's River in order to facilitate the approach of the Northern Army to Albany, he wrote in 1779, in an effort to explain the reasoning that helped bring about the catastrophic defeat at Saratoga. What would have been the consequences of such an expedition? Asked Howe, who went on to answer his own question. Before the object of it would have been attained, the forts in the highlands must have been carried, which would probably have cost a considerable number of men, defended as they would have been by Washington's whole force. But these forts being carried, how would the enemy have acted? In one of these two ways, he would either have put himself between me and New York, or between me and the Northern Army. In either case, I am of opinion that the success of our efforts upon Hudson's River could not, from the many difficulties in penetrating though so very strong a country, have been accomplished in time to have possession of Philadelphia that campaign. But, admitting I had at length reached Albany, what should I have gained after having expended the campaign upon that object alone, that I had not a right to expect by drawing off General Washington with the principal American army from any operations on this side? When it is considered how invidious and how minute a scrutiny has been made into my conduct, I shall not be thought to speak absurdly if I say that, had I adopted the plan of going up Hudson's River, it would have been alleged that I had wasted the campaign with a considerable army under my command, merely to ensure the progress of the Northern Army, which could have taken care of itself, provided I had made a diversion in its favor by drawing off to the southward the main army under General Washington. Unbeknownst to Howe, however, John Burgoyne returned to London during the winter with orders from his commander, Guy Carleton, to report on the needs and intent of the Northern Army. During the voyage across the Atlantic, Burgoyne jotted down notes and took the liberty to elaborate upon Carleton's plans for 1777. Once in London, Burgoyne met with Lord Germain and King George III to share his plan. The primary objective of his army, he began, would be the capture of Fort Ticonderoga. Thereafter, argued Burgoyne, the sole purpose of the Canada Army was to effect a junction with General Howe, or, after cooperating so far as to get possession of Albany and open communication to New York, to remain upon the Hudson's River, and thereby enable that general to act with his whole force to the southward. Throughout the planning process, Burgoyne assumed he would eventually form a juncture with Howe. George III agreed with Burgoyne's plans, stating that his force should move down to Albany and join at that with Howe's army. Therefore, in March 1777, Burgoyne received orders to lead the Canadian Army south along the Lake Champlain-Hudson River corridor and form a junction with Howe. These orders fell in line with the original plan to isolate New England. Once Burgoyne reached Albany, he was to put himself under the command of Sir William Howe. No matter what complications Burgoyne may encounter along the way, he was never to lose sight of the intended junction with Sir William Howe as their, Burgoyne's army's, principal objective. Germain promised Howe that he would keep him informed of Burgoyne's orders, but no such communication ever took place. Burgoyne went into the campaign assuming Howe would stick to the original plan and clear the lower Hudson River Valley. Although a copy of Burgoyne's orders was not sent to Howe, the long-standing Hudson River operation was more than familiar to him. Howe, meanwhile, sent dispatches to Lord Germain informing him that his objective had changed. Burgoyne never learned of Howe's change of plan, and Germain was left to reconcile the vexing issue. It is clear that Lord George expected the armies to join, that he assumed Howe understood the general plan, and that he believed Howe could take Philadelphia and join Burgoyne in a single campaign. Most historians lay blame for the failures of 1777 at the feet of Lord Germain, but they fail to properly consider the limitations of 18th-century communication. Germain had no choice but to rely on face-to-face contact with his subordinates or dispatches sent back and forth across the Atlantic Ocean. Sending an inquiry by ship and getting a response could take up to 2 months. By the time a letter or order arrived, it was already outdated. Germain had no personal contact with Howe during this period. Both Burgoyne and Henry Clinton, a subordinate from Howe's army, returned to London that winter, and Germain had to carefully weigh the information and opinions offered up by these self-serving officers. When George III approved Burgoyne's revision of the Hudson River plan and Howe's Philadelphia thrust, it was Germain's duty to point out the contradictory orders to the king, or at least to inform the two principal generals of the coming campaign of the differences in their orders. Burgoyne's advance was undertaken with the full understanding that Howe would indeed support him, but not until Burgoyne had reached Albany. Part of the problem plaguing British commanders in the field was that neither Germain nor the king had ever led troops in battle and were thus unfamiliar with the difficulties of moving armies through the enemy countryside. What little they knew pertained to European warfare, where well-developed roads and farms could better transport and support large field armies. The relative wilderness of North America, however, lacked a quality road network and, in most areas, remained heavily wooded and undeveloped. British planners seem never to have considered the ability of American militia to disrupt their movements. Germain's and King George III's misunderstanding of these conditions led them to believe that Howe, within just a few months, could not only capture Philadelphia, but return to the Hudson River and assist Burgoyne. Howe's blind ambition to capture the colonial capital played a major part in the disaster that befell Burgoyne in the fall of 1777 at Saratoga. However, argued one historian, it would be mistaken to assume that Howe sacrificed Burgoyne either through indifference or stupidity. Howe had no enthusiasm for the New England plan, but a lack of enthusiasm for it leaves the impression that the failure of the government to send Howe's reinforcements, as numerous as he wished, put him in a mood prejudicial to a sympathetic handling of the problem presented by Burgoyne's advance. Despite his obsession with the city, Howe took an inordinate amount of time to achieve his goal, and by that late hour Burgoyne's fate was already sealed. By the spring of 1777, the British High Command knew of Howe's intentions and approved his plans. In a long letter to Germain, Howe explained that Washington would be forced to move south and defend his capital. If he was wrong and Washington moved up the Hudson River Valley, Howe would turn and follow. Several weeks later, events in the field proved that Howe's basic assumption was correct. Washington moved to block Howe from taking Philadelphia, which meant the American army could not play a role in the Hudson River operations. The 1776 campaign had demonstrated many things, and one in particular. William Howe lacked a killer's instinct. He chased, pushed, attacked, and pressured his opponent, but somehow he was never able to commit to a final mortal blow against even a weakened enemy. Lord Germain preferred a scorched-earth policy and reasoned that the rebellion would not end until the main rebel army was eliminated. That policy made little sense to Howe, who believed such brutality would further alienate the Americans and set the stage for future civil wars, even if Britain achieved victory. Winning the hearts and minds of the people was more important than military annihilation. Howe intended to use persuasion in conjunction with demonstrated military might, employing their martial resources to prod the rebels into renewing their allegiance to the crown. Capturing the capital would achieve this with no change to his personal strategy. Washington's strategy. Congress's choice of George Washington to lead the first American army was, in many ways, a curious one. The Virginia planter had exercised limited departmental command during the French and Indian War, and had never led more than a regiment or two in combat. Despite a personal desire to have done so, Washington never served as a British regular, nor had he attended any of the military schools in Europe. Confronted by some of the best military professionals of the 18th century, Washington faced a steep learning curve. Despite his victories at Trenton and Princeton, he and his army had been battered, beaten, and outgeneraled throughout 1776. The overarching lesson of 1776 was simple. The fledgling American army was not yet capable of waging traditional warfare. Washington learned that lesson and would spend 1777 relying on defensive warfare, daybreak assaults, sneak attacks, and trickery, a strategy of guerrilla or partisan warfare, petite guerre. The planter-turned-general realized it would take time to mold the Continental Army into a force that could stand toe-to-toe with British regulars. That fact became more than clear after his near annihilation on Long Island and other defeats. In order to buy that time, Washington changed his strategy and spent most of the rest of the war avoiding pitched battles, especially offensive combat. This approach would keep his army intact for the long haul, but Washington still needed to settle on a strategy to defeat the British. He could have waged a guerrilla-style war with smaller forces to slowly drain British strength, but the members of Congress, who had to answer to their constituents, wanted to defend every colony and every major city. The public in general supported such a policy. Its implementation, however, would have required Washington to spread his limited manpower too thin to achieve anything, and all but guaranteed an American defeat. Washington needed a strategy that would be effective with the sparse resources he had under his control or within his reach. Washington became best known for implementing a Fabian style of warfare. While he preferred a large professional army and constantly begged Congress for one, he was also a realist. The relatively small army he had was easier to supply and could move more rapidly than could its British and Hessian counterparts. When not acting on the defensive, Washington could attack rapidly and retreat even more quickly. His tactics prevented heavy casualties, maintained his army, and allowed him to live to fight another day. By avoiding major battles and using the wilds of North America, Washington hoped to frustrate the British by making the war too long and too expensive to maintain. Despite the realities under which he labored, Washington harbored a strong desire to wage a classic battle against the British Army on something approaching equal terms. As historian Ron Chernow observed, Washington nursed fantasies throughout the war about fighting a grand climactic battle that would end the conflict with a single stroke. The only way he could ever have such an opportunity was to maintain and train his Continentals until his men were ready for the challenge. Washington described this strategy as time, caution, and worrying the enemy until we could be better provided with arms and other means and had better disciplined troops to carry on. The longer the war continued, the more unpopular it became in Parliament, especially as the cost of conducting the war skyrocketed. Washington firmly believed the British government would grow weary of losing men and materiel, despise the rising costs of the war, and weaken in the face of increasing criticism from the opposition party. Time was on Washington's side. When the spring campaign season dawned, Washington was in something of a quandary, for he had no idea what strategy William Howe would implement. The British general had several options, in the proximity of a royal fleet commanded by his brother, Admiral Richard Howe. The lack of a credible Continental Navy limited Washington's options. Howe could use his fleet to move north up the Hudson River, jump to any number of ports along the American coastline, or move directly overland to Philadelphia, picking up where the previous campaign had ended. Washington, who was in no position to assume the initiative, would have to wait and react. His position around Morristown would allow him to block the overland route to Philadelphia. If Howe pushed north along the Hudson to meet the British force from Canada, Washington would follow and harass his rear. If Howe completely changed the field of operations by using the British fleet, Washington would have no choice but to wait and see where the British army appeared and then act accordingly. Chapter 1. The Philadelphia Campaign, June to September, 1777. Our people behaved well, but heaven frowned upon us in a degree. We were obliged to retire after a very considerable slaughter of the enemy. Henry Knox, Chief of Artillery, Continental Army, September 1777. George Washington spent the 6 months after his victories at Trenton and Princeton in late December 1776 and early January 1777 around Morristown, New Jersey, building a new army nearly from scratch. His one-year enlistments, which comprised most of his army in 1776, had expired. During the long and arduous process, Washington harassed British outposts scattered across northern New Jersey in a series of raids and skirmishes. Fortunately for him, British General William Howe was more concerned with strategic planning and writing letters to London than with what he considered the minor doings of the Continental Army. Between January and June 1777, these small-scale raids and skirmishes were the only military operations that took place in northern New Jersey. The American Revolution had devolved into something more closely resembling a guerrilla war than the more traditional European style of combat. Washington described this form of war in a letter that February. "There have been, and almost daily are, some small skirmishes," he explained, "but without much loss on either side." Happily, for Washington and the American cause, this form of warfare continued for the next 4 months, giving the general the precious time and space he needed to rebuild his weakened army. The stress built up during the extended off-tempo, low-intensity war simmered through the spring of 1777 until it boiled over into the savageness exhibited later in the campaign, especially at Paoli. The rains of April ended in early May, and Washington, his army still in flux, shifted his command from the winter encampment at Morristown to a position at Middlebrook, New Jersey. General Howe mostly ignored Washington's change of base and made little effort to open the 1777 campaign season. He intended to capture Philadelphia as rapidly as possible and return to New York to join forces with General John Burgoyne and the Northern Army. Yet he showed no sign of urgency to actually do so. Nicholas Cresswell, an Englishman soon to return to England, noted in his journal, "I am as ignorant of the motions or designs of our army as if I had been in Virginia." The British soldiers, added Cresswell, "seem very healthy and long to be in action." June 1777. William Howe finally lurched into action in June by ordering an expedition to Middlebush, New Jersey. The British commander decided his best bet was to attempt the overland route to Philadelphia in the hope of luring Washington down from his mountain stronghold. Defeating Washington in New Jersey and then marching to Philadelphia offered Howe the best chance to take the colonial capital and leave in time to aid Burgoyne in New York. Howe's delay in opening the campaign triggered some dissatisfaction within the British officer corps. Timing was crucial to the British plan, and the army could have moved weeks earlier when the winter rains stopped and the warmer weather dried the roads. However, Howe did not move into northern New Jersey until June 13th. To the disbelief of officers on both sides, the British army stopped after a march of about 10 miles and established camp the day after reaching its destination. Not only did the army stop its advance, but Howe ordered fortifications erected. He apparently no longer intended to move any farther toward Philadelphia through New Jersey. "Nobody in the world could be more careful than he is," wrote Howe's Hessian aide, Captain Levin Friedrich Ernst von Munchausen, in defense of his chief's actions. "This is absolutely necessary in this cursed hilly country." By remaining stationary, Howe intended to draw Washington down from the high ground and offer him battle in the relatively flat country east of the mountain range. To Howe's dismay, Washington refused to take the bait. The failure to lure the Americans into a fight flummoxed Howe, whose army of professional soldiers was being stymied by Washington's ragtag collection of militia, frontiersmen, and Continental regulars. No one believed Washington's force was formidable, including Washington himself. This was not the army of veterans that would become hardened and molded in the grueling campaign still ahead of them, followed by the reckoning that would take place at Valley Forge the following winter. 4 days ticked past as Howe waited in frustration for Washington to move. Other than light skirmishing and the launching of small raiding parties to plunder the countryside, Howe accomplished nothing. By remaining idle during perfectly good weather, Howe had effectively removed his army from the war effort. Howe gave up the game and returned to New Brunswick on June 19th as elements of the Continental Army followed, skirmishing fitfully with his rear guard. Howe's actions dumbfounded British Major Charles Stuart. "These retrograde movements appear just as incomprehensible to us as they can possibly to you," he wrote his father in England. Howe's half-hearted attempt in New Jersey was as baffling then as it is today. Even though he was on a tight schedule, he moved thousands of troops 10 miles, went into camp and constructed earthworks, waited 4 days, and returned to his starting point a week later. Most historians attribute Howe's actions to a failed effort to pull Washington from the mountains for an open field fight. However, Washington had never so obliged his enemy, and in fact rarely fought a battle under his enemy's terms. The more logical explanation is that Howe never intended to assault Philadelphia by marching through New Jersey. He would reach his objective by using the British fleet to transport his army. On June 22nd, Howe retired farther to Amboy, New Jersey, to load his army and its baggage for the voyage to the Delaware River. The Americans pressed Howe's rear guard, harassing the tail of his column. Washington remained cautiously optimistic about the state of affairs. "I cannot say that the move I am about to make towards Amboy accords altogether with my opinion," wrote the army commander. "Not that I am under any other apprehension than that of being obliged to loose ground again, which would indeed be no small misfortune, as the spirits of our troops and the country is greatly revived, and, I presume, the enemies not a little depressed by their late retrograde motions." Washington's willingness to come down off the high ground and pursue Howe's retreating army, however, provided the British general with the opportunity he had been seeking. The Continental Army was on more engageable terrain, and Howe had his chance to attack. He did just that on June 25th by turning and assaulting Major General Lord Stirling's isolated and heavily outnumbered American division of some 2,500 men. Stirling waged a well-crafted fighting withdrawal and took up a strong defensive position in the area of Ash Swamp and Scotch Plains. The British pushed hard and forced Stirling's command back once more toward Westfield. Suffering under an intense sun, Howe called off the pursuit and the day's fighting ended. The defensive action cost Stirling perhaps as many as 100 killed and wounded, in addition to 70 men and 3 cannons captured, while British losses totaled just 5 killed and 30 wounded. The Battle of Short Hills, as it became known, bought precious time for Washington to move the balance of his army into the hill country, to deny Howe the opportunity of the larger pitched battle he so craved. The affair also demonstrated that Washington's vaunted spy network had been surprised and, thus, had failed him. The British army, camped a mere 8 miles away, had stolen a march on Washington and defeated a portion of the Continental Army. Howe had been unable to bring Washington to battle, but his short-lived romp across the Jersey countryside had made one thing clear. The large and often lumbering British army could move about the countryside, plundering as it went, and there was little Washington could or would do about it. By June 28, Howe was back in Amboy, his attempt to defeat Washington in northern New Jersey at an end. Washington fully expected Howe to use the British fleet to change the field of operations, but where would the ships carry his army? "By means of their shipping and the easy transportation that shipping affords, they have it much in their power to lead us in a very disagreeable dance," Washington wrote in a letter to his brother, John Augustine Washington. On the last day of June, Howe removed the last of his troops from New Jersey and returned to Staten Island, New York. He and his command were back where they had started before their attack on New York City nearly a year earlier. The city and its environs, together with Newport, Rhode Island, remained under British control, but Howe's withdrawal allowed Washington and his Continental Army to assume complete control of New Jersey. The strategic situation disgusted Loyalist Nicholas Cresswell. "General Howe, a man brought up to war from his youth, to be puzzled and plagued for 2 years together with a Virginia tobacco planter. O Britain, how thy laurels tarnish in the hands of such a lubber!" While Howe pondered his next move, Washington redeployed his command, shifting 3 brigades into the Hudson River Valley in case Howe headed in that direction. "Their fleet," he explained in a letter to Congress, "give them the most signal advantages and opportunity of practicing 1,000 feints." July 1777. Early July found most of the Continental Army back in the mountains around Morristown. The position provided Washington with the option of shifting north to block the Hudson River or south to protect the capital. The next move was up to Howe. Determined to use his fleet to reach Philadelphia, on July 8 the British general began the arduous process of loading his army onto transport ships. Howe believed he could ascend the Delaware River, capture Philadelphia, and still aid Burgoyne in a timely fashion. He also believed that moving by sea would freeze the Americans in place until Washington realized where Howe was going. On the second point, he was correct. By the time Howe finished the loading process on July 9, he had filled some 260 ships with 20,000 soldiers, support personnel, artillery, horses, and everything else he needed to launch a major campaign. Rather than depart immediately, however, Howe left his men and animals bobbing in the harbor for several days, confined in tight, overheated quarters aboard stuffy transports. "God knows whether we shall go south or north," wrote a perplexed Colonel Carl von Donop, the commander of the Hessian Grenadiers. "But the heat which is beginning to make itself felt with the approach of the dog days makes one wish that the general would choose north rather than south." The delay also confused Howe's Hessian aide, Captain Friedrich von Munchausen, who observed, "No one seems to be able to figure out why we are waiting here so long, considering the fact that everyone except Howe and a few officers are aboard ship." Washington, aware Howe was loading ships for a campaign, decided to get a jump on him by moving the army north on July 12 to the New Jersey-New York border in anticipation of a push up the Hudson River. Leaving New Jersey wide open for Howe to make an overland forced march for Philadelphia was a bold and risky decision that Howe failed to recognize or exploit. The deliberate British general was finally ready to move on July 20. He ordered the large British armada to sail out of New York Harbor, leaving behind General Henry Clinton and the city's garrison of 7,400 troops. American observers along the New Jersey coast speculated that the fleet was turning south, but at this point, Howe's target was still an open question. The lack of a continental navy hampered Washington, who was forced to rely upon spotters scattered along the coastline to locate the ships and relay information. Until reliable intelligence arrived, Washington had no choice but to mark time in northern New Jersey. Howe's voyage promised to be long and slow, for the prevailing summer winds along the Atlantic coast tend to blow north, and Howe was heading south. The journey was a miserable experience for man and beast alike. The heat and humidity were stifling, and brisk winds buffeted the ships. Frequent late-afternoon thunderstorms added to the general misery of the voyage. The weather proved so uncooperative that it took the fleet a week to travel only 150 miles to Cape May, New Jersey. Washington, meanwhile, concentrated near Ramapo, New Jersey, a position from which he could either march to the Hudson Highlands or move rapidly to Philadelphia. On July 26, shore-based spotters sighted a large portion of the British fleet heading south near Little Egg Harbor, New Jersey. Washington was beginning to hedge his bets and had been slowly moving south, inching toward Morristown with four of the Army's five divisions. The Continental Army headed for three separate crossings of the Delaware River to expedite its passage into Pennsylvania, if warranted. When news of the fleet found its way to Washington, there was little doubt Howe was heading for Philadelphia. On July 28, the leading elements of Washington's legions reached the Delaware. The final days of July saw the British fleet tacking into the Delaware Bay to assess current conditions and intelligence about Washington's army. When this news reached Washington about 24 hours later, he ordered the army to cross into Pennsylvania to block a move against Philadelphia. Almost simultaneously, the Howe brothers made what was, perhaps, the most critical decision of 1777 aboard bobbing ships in Delaware Bay. The British general and admiral acted upon incorrect information that Washington's entire army was across the Delaware and approaching Wilmington, Delaware. They were also told that fortifications had been constructed along the shores of the Delaware, and various obstructions had been placed in the river to halt the fleet. The news should have elated the British High Command. The river defenses and a small naval militia were of trifling concern when the most important city in North America was essentially undefended. the Schuylkill and Brandywine rivers that stood between the army and the colonial capital would have to be crossed, but they could be forded at numerous locations. Although William Howe was informed that Washington's army was west of the Delaware River, little, if any, of the Continental Army had yet to arrive in Philadelphia. The British had a clear and open path to the American capital. Despite easy access to Philadelphia, which was approximately 90 miles away by ship, Howe decided to sail south to Chesapeake Bay, where he could put his troops ashore without molestation, have time to recover the horses after the fatigue of the voyage before they entered service, and where the transports could remain in perfect security. The move, he also stressed, would threaten backcountry settlements. On July 31, the fleet headed back to sea. Howe later claimed the shift farther south benefited John Burgoyne by drawing Washington away from the Hudson River Valley. In reality, the moment William Howe gave the order to steer toward the Chesapeake, he eliminated any possibility of aiding Burgoyne. The sailing of the British fleet removed the immediate threat to Philadelphia, but it did not stop panic from erupting inside the capital. City officials ordered that all wagons be detained for the removal of anything that might aid the enemy. Congress passed a resolution recommending to make prisoners such of the late Crown and proprietary officers and other persons in and near this city as are disaffected or may be dangerous to the public liberty and send them back into the country, there to be confined or enlarged upon parole as their characters and behavior may require. Two of the most prominent arrestees included Governor John Penn, grandson of founder William Penn, and Chief Justice Benjamin Chew, a prominent Philadelphia lawyer and owner of a large stone home in the village of Germantown. August 1777. By the beginning of August, the British fleet was moving south along the Delaware coast. The move left Washington with a conundrum. Was Howe making for the Hudson River, or was his objective one of the port cities farther south? Washington concentrated his command just north of Philadelphia, with four of his divisions camped in and around the village of Germantown on the outskirts of the city. The British strategy also perplexed members of Congress, including John Adams. "What this man, Howe, is after," he wrote, "no wisdom can discover." By August 10, Washington had shifted his army to the banks of Neshaminy Creek, north of Philadelphia and closer to the Delaware River, in case he needed to rush back to the Hudson Highlands. There was little more he could do until definitive intelligence arrived confirming the location of Howe's fleet. Washington may well have smiled had he known that the fleet had reached the entrance to Chesapeake Bay after suffering through terrible storms. Fresh food and water had run out on many transports, and horses were dying by the score and being tossed overboard. When news of Howe's location, if not his army's condition, arrived on August 21, Washington scrambled to move the scattered elements of his army into a position to confront the British south of Philadelphia. Washington started inching towards northern Delaware to block Howe. With the British fleet anchored near the mouth of the Elk River in the upper reaches of Chesapeake Bay, Washington shifted the Continental Army back into the Germantown area. Howe was going for Philadelphia and would approach from the southwest. The terrain there was cut with several creeks and rivers that would slow but not stop Howe's access to the city, including the Red and White Clay Creeks, the Brandywine, and the Schuylkill. Washington also was concerned that Howe would march into the interior and threaten the major American supply depots at Lancaster or Reading. There was no real choice. He would have to advance toward Howe. On August 24, Washington paraded his troops from their Germantown camps through Philadelphia en route to Delaware. It was time to block Howe's approaches to Philadelphia. The next morning, Washington crossed into Delaware with two divisions and camped along Nahman's Creek. About the same time, Howe began offloading troops in northeastern Maryland. Other than some local militia that Howe brushed aside, his landing was unmolested. Now that Howe had landed, making a connection with the Delaware River was imperative. Throughout the war, the British were in short supply of land transportation. Howe's logistical concerns were compounded by the fact that many of his horses had died during the voyage. It was vitally important for British armies to operate in the field near navigable rivers so the Royal Navy could resupply them. In fact, points out one recent historian, the insecurity of overland communications restricted an army's maximum operational range to about 15 to 20 miles from navigable water. This operational conundrum affected Howe's decision-making throughout the campaign. Had he landed in northern Delaware at the end of July, he would have had his connection with the Delaware River. Now, Howe was barely back on land, and he had no choice but to operate along the Delaware River, ignoring the reason he initially provided for delaying the campaign for another month by shifting his army farther south. On August 28, the British advanced from their landing site, brushing aside American militia and plundering the countryside. The initial move overran the commercial trading village at Head of Elk, Maryland. By August 31, Howe was devastating the countryside in northeastern Maryland in search of badly needed supplies, including reinforcements and fresh horses. Contrary to Howe's belief, Loyalists had little interest in flocking to his standard. The prevailing disposition of the inhabitants who, I am sorry to observe, seems to be, excepting a few individuals, strongly in enmity against us, Howe complained to Lord Germain. Many, having taken up arms and, by far the greater number, deserted their dwellings, driving off at the same time their stock of cattle and horses. Howe later claimed that the real reason he could not support Burgoyne's army was the failure to recruit Loyalist support. Excuses for abandoning Burgoyne were growing larger with each telling. Three factors worked against British recruitment efforts. First, Loyalists in the region were conservative, cautious, and against violence. Because of this, Quakers were viewed as Loyalists. Second, the British Army treated Loyalists poorly. Rather than grant British Army commissions and the permanence that came with them, they gave Loyalists temporary provincial commissions. Even though these people remained loyal to King George III, the British viewed them as inferior second-class citizens, and provincial units were often relegated to non-combat roles like wagon guards and garrison duty. Finally, Loyalists who came forward when the British occupied a region were often abandoned when the invaders eventually left, leaving them open to abuse by rebel forces. By late August, Washington, who had gathered an army outside Wilmington, nearly equal in size to Howe's, was fully aware of the British supply problems, especially their dire lack of healthy horses. All accounts agree that the enemy are very much distressed for want of horses, numbers of which, it is said, died on the passage, and the rest are in exceeding bad order, wrote the American commander. This will probably occasion some delay and give time for the militia, who seem to be collecting pretty fast, to join us. Unfortunately for Washington, the British equine shortage prompted Howe to offer high prices for mounts, and many American dragoons deserted to collect the inducement. September 1777. By the beginning of September, Howe's soldiers were itching for action. They had spent several weeks cooped up on ships and the last several days conducting a fitful and frustrating advance into northeastern Maryland. Howe was as ready as he would ever be to risk a battle. He had been avoiding a pitched confrontation, but the campaign season was rapidly winding down, and there was precious little to show for it. Washington had an outpost in northern Delaware at Cooch's Bridge on the Christiana River, which Howe would have to deal with in order to reach the main colonial army. He did just that on September 3, sending 450 Jaegers and 1,300 light infantrymen on a series of flanking movements against 1,000 Americans under William Maxwell. The fighting lasted some 7 hours before Maxwell's men ran out of ammunition and fled across the bridge and eventually back toward Wilmington, leaving the British in command of the banks of the Christiana River. The battle, which carried Howe one step closer to Philadelphia, was the largest land engagement in the history of Delaware. Once he achieved this success, however, Howe settled down for another 5 days to pillage the countryside. Feeding his army was imperative, Providing for it in a hostile land was a constant problem. Following Cooch's Bridge, Washington convinced himself that Howe would take the main road into Wilmington. He deployed his army behind the Red Clay Creek with a defense in depth. Since Howe never resorted to frontal assaults, Washington's thinking is a mystery. At Long Island, White Plains, Short Hills, and Cooch's Bridge, Howe utilized flanking movements to avoid a bloody attack. Given his history, Howe's next move was predictable. On September 8, he resorted to what he did best and gained the Pennsylvania border ahead of Washington. By late morning, the bulk of Howe's army was camped on the hills around Hockessin, Delaware, well above Washington's right flank. Outgeneraled yet again, Washington scrambled to get his army in motion and into a blocking position to protect Philadelphia. After months of confusion and outright misery, Howe's latest moves impressed his officers and men alike. "All marched in one column, and to our great surprise," wrote Howe's aide, von Munchausen, "instead of taking the road by way of Christiana Bridge to Wilmington as expected, we went to our left by way of White Clay Creek and Newark. Everyone is pleased with the good march and the fact that it was kept a secret, thus cutting off Washington from Lancaster." In the middle of the night, Washington pulled the Continental Army from northern Delaware, marched north, and by the next day began moving into positions on the east side of the Brandywine River near Chad's Ford in Pennsylvania. Between the evening of September 9 and the morning of September 10, Howe's army moved north parallel to Washington's position and camped at Kennett Square, about 6 miles west of the American army. Washington had spent the long summer months attempting to hinder British movements with militia and other troops, while seeking a favorable opportunity to make a stand should one become necessary. The terrain along the Brandywine River provided him with exactly that. The Battle of Brandywine. The Battle of Brandywine was the longest and largest single-day engagement of the war. The fighting on September 11, 1777, is also a study of contradictions. George Washington hoped a stout defense along the rolling terrain hugging the Brandywine River would bar British access to Philadelphia. His goal was to defend its various crossings and prevent Howe from gaining access to the East Bank. Although Washington had his troops in position east of the Brandywine a full day before the fighting began, he failed to gather all the intelligence needed to execute his defensive battle plan. He intended to use the river to block Howe's advance, yet remained almost completely ignorant of the surrounding terrain and road network, and failed to identify and guard all the fords available to the British. There was a lack of reconnaissance patrols. Even more alarming was that no one in a position of authority thought to speak to the many local residents serving in the Continental Army. The result, argued one writer, was an American army even more uncertain of the immediate nature of the country than were the British. Washington did not know the region and did not take the precaution of having at hand someone who knew the countryside. Earlier in the war, Washington reasoned that we should on all occasions avoid a general action or put anything to the risk unless compelled by a necessity into which we ought never to be drawn. By early September 1777, Washington's Continental Army had been maneuvered into a position that warranted and necessitated a pitched battle. Giving up Philadelphia without a fight was not an option. While Washington prepared for battle with little terrain knowledge and even less help from the locals, William Howe made his plans with the advantage of both. Pennsylvania Loyalist Joseph Galloway and others provided Howe with everything he needed to know about local terrain conditions and the road network. Washington's position east of the Brandywine limited Howe's options. A frontal assault against the American positions would be too costly and the men hard to replace. Howe, who strove to avoid direct assaults, preferred sending a diversionary force forward against the center of an enemy's main position to pin him in place, and a strong column on a flanking march to turn the enemy out of his position. Howe had used this same tactic repeatedly and recently against Washington, but the Virginian had not yet taken the lesson to heart and was consistently unprepared for Howe's predictable maneuver. Brandywine was merely a repeat of Howe's performance on other fields. He sent Wilhelm von Niefhausen's division ahead to pin Washington in place, then executed a wide left hook under the command of General Cornwallis that surprised the Americans by appearing beyond their vulnerable right flank. Washington discovered the move too late to prevent it, a glaring failure of intelligence gathering. To his credit, he shifted the bulk of his army to oppose it and conducted a dogged defensive action that cost Howe dearly. Howe's success that day can be evenly credited to both his good generalship and to Washington's failures. Although the Continental Army had suffered a tactical defeat along the Brandywine, Washington's men fought remarkably well. William Maxwell's Light Infantry Brigade conducted the morning's delaying action in splendid fashion, and the divisions of Adam Stephen, Lord Stirling, and John Sullivan found good defensive ground and fought hard upon it when ordered to confront Howe's flanking column. They were ultimately defeated through no fault of their own. Nathaniel Greene's men turned in a solid performance and kept the roads open for the American retreat. They suffered some 1,300 casualties, with 300 killed, 600 wounded, and 400 missing or captured. Given the trying circumstances, the Continentals had done their job as well or better than anyone could have reasonably expected. Washington's poor use of scouts and the intelligence they produced haunted him throughout that long day. Howe, on the other hand, gathered accurate information about local terrain conditions despite operating in hostile territory. His flanking maneuver, which was based on that intelligence, worked almost to perfection. His veteran British and Hessian troops performed well and did all that was asked of them. Niefhausen's division played its diversionary role exceedingly well, deceiving Washington through most of the day as to Howe's true intentions. Cornwallis's division executed a grueling flank march, deployed, and broke the American lines in a frontal assault. British losses approached 600, with 93 killed and nearly 500 wounded. Fortunately for the Americans, Howe was hampered by a lack of mounted troops, which prevented him from pursuing his defeated enemy. Though they lost the battle, many Americans found reasons for optimism. "Notwithstanding, we gave the enemy the ground. The purchase has been at much blood," explained General Nathaniel Greene. "This being by far the greatest loss they have met with since the commencement of the war." General George Weedon, one of Greene's brigade commanders, agreed. "Fake intelligence saved his, Howe's, bacon that day, or in all probability America would have had just cause to adore the name of Brandywine to the latest posterity." Continental Artillery Chief Henry Knox concurred, writing to his wife, "Our people behaved well, but heaven frowned upon us is a degree. We were obliged to retire after a very considerable slaughter of the enemy." Washington knew serious mistakes had been made, though he was not yet ready to admit that he had been the one who had made them. "Unfortunately, the intelligence received of the enemy's advancing up the Brandywine and crossing at a ford about 6 miles above us was uncertain and contradictory," he reported immediately after the battle, "notwithstanding all my pains to get the best." Many British and Hessian officers channeled these thoughts and heaped praise on the Continental Army. "As far as I can tell," admitted Howe's Hessian aide, Captain von Munchausen, "Washington executed a masterpiece of strategy today by sending columns from his right to his left wing in the beginning. Soon after this, Washington withdrew from his left wing. All this was done with great speed and especially good order." Rather than praise his enemy, Cornwallis applauded Howe by writing, "The maneuver that brought on the action of Brandywine certainly reflects the highest honor on the general, Howe." Hessian Captain Johann Ewald was pleased by the victory, but realized the British had missed a rare opportunity. "Had General Howe set out 2 hours earlier, or marched faster, Washington's army would have been caught between two fires. Several good friends from headquarters assured me that this mistake was caused by the guides, who had declared the route shorter than we found it to be." The frustrated von Munchausen summarized that Washington's escape that night happened because the Patriots could not be pursued by us because of the darkness, and his still fresh men who knew the terrain very well could have the same advantage they would have in daylight. Washington's retreat from the Brandywine didn't end the fighting for Philadelphia, but it was the seminal engagement of the 1777 Philadelphia campaign. The next several weeks would witness several small skirmishes and other encounters, including the Battle of Germantown, Washington's bold attempt to recapture the lost capital city. Brandywine's aftermath. Late on the evening of September 11th, Washington and his army were retreating in haste from the battlefield at Brandywine toward Chester, Pennsylvania, reaching the port town along the Delaware River about midnight. While some of the troops had arrived ahead of the commander-in-chief, much of the army was strung out on several roads and paths stretching all the way back to the battlefield, about 14 miles to the northwest. The exhausted Washington desperately needed a few hours of rest, but took several minutes to pen a quick report to John Hancock, the president of the Congress. "I am sorry to inform you," he began, "that in this day's engagement we have been obliged to leave the enemy masters of the field." After blaming faulty intelligence, Washington concluded on an optimistic note. "Our loss of men is not, I am persuaded, very considerable. I believe much less than the enemy's." The general civilian population of Chester County spent the next several days dealing with the repercussions of the battle, while the politicians in Philadelphia debated whether the defeat meant that the capital was lost. Washington, who needed to reorganize his army, was pleased when early reports demonstrated that nearly 11,000 troops were again present for duty just a few days after Brandywine. This was just 1,000 fewer Continentals than he had taken into battle. Not surprisingly, few of the 3,000 militiamen present at Brandywine reappeared within the Army's ranks. More time was needed to gather the Pennsylvania militia and get them back into the fold. Thus far in the campaign, the militia from Delaware, Maryland, and Pennsylvania had not earned much respect from the Continentals. The militias had done precious little to interfere with Howe's plunderous march through northeastern Maryland and northern Delaware. The sizable division of Pennsylvania militia that had joined the army along the Brandywine had been wisely relegated to a minor role in the battle, because Washington knew he could not rely on them when most needed. John Armstrong, who commanded the Pennsylvania militia at Brandywine, agreed with this assessment. "Many, too many, of the militia were a scandal to the military profession, a nuisance in service, and a dead weight on the public," he declared. Still, Armstrong did not think it fair to compare the militia with the Continental Line, and he also believed the part-time soldiers had many men in the ranks who would stand and fight. Many judged the militia from a single action, and still worse, brand the whole with the infamous conduct of only a part. General Howe did little to interfere with Washington's efforts to regroup in the immediate aftermath of the battle. For 4 days, Howe kept most of his army on the battlefield instead of launching a vigorous pursuit. In truth, Howe's army was exhausted. The soldiers had endured a long, tedious voyage, followed by hard marching and prolonged combat with sustained casualties. They were in no condition to drive ahead and had earned a much-needed rest. "The fatigues of this day were excessive," confirmed Lieutenant Loftus Cliff of the 46th Regiment of Foot. "If you knew the weight a poor soldier carried, the length of time he is obliged to be on foot for a train of artillery to move 17 miles, the duties he goes through when near an enemy, and that the whole night of the 9th we were marching, you would say we had done our duty on the 11th. While men on both sides claimed the Americans had dealt Howe a severe blow, Captain Richard Fitzpatrick of the British Brigade of Guards thought such talk was without foundation. "Some foolish people were much elated with this event, Brandywine, and an insufferable torrent of nonsense was talked for some time afterwards, such as that the whole army must disperse, that it was impossible they should ever recover from so severe a blow, etc., etc. but these silly fellows were soon convinced that they had no foundation for their opinions. Washington still continued to talk high language. Besides resting his army, Howe had other matters to handle. Hundreds of wounded men needed medical care, and the dead had to be buried. The army needed to establish a bridgehead at Wilmington to evacuate the injured, the seriously ill, and the collected provisions to a safe garrison town. Insufficient wagons and the paucity of healthy horses hampered Howe's operational ability, and it took several days to accomplish these tasks. With the dawn of September 12th came an order from Washington for the army to move out, while also doing everything possible to round up stragglers and put them back in the ranks. "The commanding officer of each brigade," he ordered, "is immediately to send off as many officers as he shall think necessary on the roads leading to the places of action yesterday, and on any other roads where stragglers may be found, particularly to Wilmington, where, 'tis said, many have retired, to pick up all the stragglers from the army and bring them on. In doing this, they will proceed as far towards the enemy as shall be consistent with their own safety and examine every house." Washington also had to carefully assess his losses and the army's fighting condition. "Each brigadier or officer commanding a brigade will immediately make the most exact returns of their killed, wounded, and missing. The officers are, without loss of time, to see that their men are completed with ammunition, that their arms are in the best order, the inside of them washed clean and well dried, the touch holes picked, and a good flint in each gun. The commanding officer of each regiment is to endeavor to procure such necessaries as are wanting for his men." With his own army back in organized motion, Washington needed to find fresh defensive ground to protect Philadelphia from Howe's victorious army. The only remaining natural barrier was the Schuylkill River. The Continentals left Chester, marched through Derby, crossed the floating bridge at the middle ferry on the Schuylkill, modern-day Market Street Bridge, and entered the outskirts of Philadelphia. "The bridge," explained one modern historian, "an unstable affair, was fashioned of pontoons roughly laid over with planking." The Pennsylvania militia was left on the near side of the river to help screen the army, which bypassed the capital by turning left and marching out to East Falls, about 5 miles from the crossing near Germantown. The long and exhausting march consumed 19 miles. Washington made his headquarters in the home of Henry Hill on the outskirts of Germantown. While passing through Derby, Washington sent a letter to Brigadier General William Smallwood. The brigadier had been detached from the army to help raise militia in his native Maryland and was organizing them around Oxford Meeting in southern Chester County. "The forces under your command," began Washington, "cannot be employed to so much advantage in any way as by falling on the enemy's rear and attacking them as often as possible. I am persuaded many advantages will result from this measure." "Such a tactic," he continued, "will greatly retard their march and give us time, and will also oblige them either to keep a string guard with their sick and wounded, with which they must now be much encumbered, or to send them back to their shipping under an escort, which you will have an opportunity of attacking with a good prospect of success." The Virginia general had fought a traditional battle along the Brandywine. Now it was time to return to a strategy of harassment. Moving the army north of the Schuylkill River put Washington behind the last natural barrier between the British and Philadelphia. The river was swift-flowing, but shallow in many spots. The falls of the Schuylkill, near modern East Falls, or rapids, splashed through large boulders where the river dropped some 30 feet. Except for the floating bridge Washington's army used to cross, there were no permanent bridges spanning the river. Philadelphia was accessible at the upper, middle, and lower ferries, and many fords farther upriver. As a defensive barrier, the Schuylkill was less than ideal. If defending the numerous fords across the Brandywine had been difficult for Washington, then defending those crossing the Schuylkill, which were more spread out, would prove a Herculean task. Most of the fords were winding, narrow affairs that snaked across a gravelly river bottom, dependent upon small islands or mud flats to complete the crossing. Hilly terrain lined the Schuylkill along much of its course, and many of the ford roads meandered down steep inclines. Any force crossing the river at such places as Fatland and Levering's Fords would find itself vulnerable to attack. The hills around Swede's Ford tapered more gently to the crossing in a wide and shallow valley, to a point where the river bottom was hard and stony. A body of troops had more room to maneuver and protect itself there. Somehow Washington would have to protect every ford and potential crossing point if he was going to defend the Schuylkill River line. Moving into the Germantown area left Washington with a vexing conundrum. The Delaware and Schuylkill Rivers form a peninsula, at the tip of which sat Philadelphia. Washington felt duty-bound to defend the capital, but he could not leave the critical supply depots at Reading and other places in the backcountry unprotected. Moving northwest to cover the depots would expose Philadelphia. Moving into position to defend Philadelphia exposed the supply centers upon which his army depended. It was now readily obvious that the loss at Brandywine made protecting the American capital nearly impossible. The security of his storehouses had to take precedence over that of the most important city in North America. Some panic set in once the residents of Philadelphia realized Washington had reached that conclusion. Many had already fled or were soon to do so. Those who remained prepared for the worst or rejoiced in secret because they backed the British cause. Numbers of the inhabitants are removing from the city, but the confusion and tumult is much less than I could have supposed, considering the very critical situation of affairs, explained James Hutchinson, a surgeon in the city. Earlier in the campaign, several prominent Quakers had been imprisoned under suspicion of aiding the British and were housed in the city's Masonic Lodge. While they never filed formal charges, Congress and the Pennsylvania Supreme Executive Council decided to release the Quakers and banish them from Philadelphia. "We have been obliged to attempt to humble the pride of some Jesuits who call themselves Quakers, but who love money and land better than liberty or religion," wrote hawkish Congressman John Adams to his wife, Abigail. "The hypocrites are endeavoring to raise the cry of persecution and to give this matter a religious turn, but they can't succeed. The world knows them and their communications," continued the future president. "American independence had disappointed them, which makes them hate it, yet the dastards dare not avow their hatred to it, it seems." Reverend Henry Muhlenberg watched as six wagons with guards passed by in Trapp, Pennsylvania, some 25 miles northeast of the Capitol. "They are to take the most prominent Quakers of Philadelphia who have been arrested to Augusta County in Virginia." The wagons and their human cargo eventually ended up in Winchester, Virginia. While Washington wrestled with his options, and while most of Howe's troops cleared the Brandywine battlefield and rested, elements of the British Army probed ahead in search of the Americans. General James Grant, with the 1st and 2nd British Brigades, a squadron of dragoons, and the Queen's Rangers, led a scouting expedition east of the Brandywine on the day after the battle. 2 miles east, they reached Concord Meeting and rounded up American stragglers. Howe sent the 71st Highlanders and elements of the Light Dragoons south 10 miles to Wilmington, Delaware to secure the town, rendezvous with the fleet, and establish a hospital. The small body of militia defending the city fled when the Highlanders approached. Members of the 71st arrested John McKinley, the president of Delaware. According to McKinley, he remained behind because it was "more solicitous to perform my duty than for my own personal safety." The Highlanders also seized 7 artillery pieces. With the port of Wilmington secured, Admiral Howe assured his brother the general that he would have several ships at Wilmington on September 15th at the latest. Most of Howe's men, meanwhile, remained idle. An aggressive pursuit of Washington's defeated army would have maintained the initiative, forced additional fighting on his terms, and likely crushed or further dispersed the Americans. Howe could have crossed the upper fords on the Schuylkill River with ease, cutting Washington off from his crucial supply depots. Earlier in the campaign, Howe told Lord Germain that he took the long route up Chesapeake Bay so he could threaten those American storehouses. But his continued lethargy gave Washington the time he required to block access to them. Like his propensity for flanking operations, Howe had a history of unenthusiastic follow-through after successful battles. Brandywine's aftermath was no different. Free from having to mount another vigorous defense, Washington took the time to congratulate his army, thanking those gallant officers and soldiers who, on the 11th instant, bravely fought in their country and its cause. He had full confidence that in another appeal to heaven, with the blessing of Providence, which it becomes every officer and soldier humbly to supplicate, we shall prove successful. Praying for the blessing of Providence only went so far, however, and Washington issued orders for the Pennsylvania militia to build redoubts above the Schuylkill River fords. While Washington praised his army and the militia prepared defensive positions, the Pennsylvania Assembly worried. What was to become of Philadelphia? Washington expressed his views to Thomas Wharton, Jr., President of the Assembly. As I am well apprised of the importance of Philadelphia, you may rest assured that I...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.